Yeah. Because I just well, I just I was at Missouri last Saturday.
Thank you. I'm so unworthy, but still you love me. Thank you. Thank you. Windy.
It's not windy, right?
How windy?
I just kissed you when I told you to see it. I don't get that. I don't get that. It's handy that we did from the bus station, wasn't it?
This short film is a reenactment of true events following an undercover field worker ministering to traffic in Northbrook.
Thank you.
Actually, Thank you. warm welcome to you all this evening. It is warm as well, isn't it? Very, very close. So we've got these fans on, I think, which should help to keep us comfortably cool. Let's hope so anyway. And it's great that we're able to meet together to worship a great God that we've been singing about. So as we begin our service this evening, let's just bring our praise to our great God. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can come and meet with you here this evening. We thank you that you are always with us, and yet, in a special way, we ask that you will be with us this evening as we meet together as a group of your people to worship you and to hear from you. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your great love for us in sending the Lord Jesus to die for us. We thank you for the fact that we can know that great love in our hearts and lives. And we thank you that that great love goes out into all the earth. And Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can experience that love. So Heavenly Father, we just pray that you'll be with us this evening in all that we do, all that we sing, all that we think, all that we hear. We pray that all will bring glory to the name of our great Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. I think the Lord has something very special to say to us this evening, as he had something very special to say to us this morning. Let me explain why I think this particularly. You see, this morning, those of you that were here will remember that the title of the talk this morning was Living Under Trials. And he was particularly talking about the trials that we face here in our lives day by day. And we read this verse from James: "Consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance." Yeah, we face trials of many kinds, don't we? But you know, there are people around the world that face many, many trials. Trials that we've no idea what they're like, because we've never faced them. And we pray, God, we will never face those trials. And this evening we're going to hear about people who are facing such trials. And so we welcome Lee Proud Love, yes, Proud Love, who represents Open Doors. I'm going to let him tell you all about Open Doors, but it's something that I hope that you will really take note of and will become interested in what Open Doors has done and is doing and will do in the future for the Lord's work all around the world. Next Sunday, Merv Jones will be speaking in the morning and Paul Sparks will be speaking in the evening. On Wednesday from 10 to 11:45, there's the Harvest Breakfast Bar, and on Friday at 7 o'clock, Praise and Worship by Task Jesus. All the other meetings that take place are on the detailed on the sheet that's provided in the foyer, the yellow sheet, on the table in reception there. Now, as many of you are aware, the church has a food bank collection point, and we realise that people who need food may present at the church from time to time, but we kindly ask that food is not removed from the collection box without first speaking to either Chris Sheldon or one of the leaders when at all possible. And an advance notice as well: church meeting on Monday the 24th of July at 7 p.m. All welcome to attend, but only those who are in church membership can vote on the proposals. And so with that, let's take up our offering now, shall we, as we bring our free will offerings to God now. Thank you.
privilege to be in your wonderful salvation. And we thank you, Father, for your invitation to come and to join with your people tonight. We thank you for your giving us an opportunity to give a little back to you. Father, we know that others may have given when they came in, others may be given directly into the bank, but you notice everything, Father, that comes into your church. And we ask, Father, that you'll take it, that you'll use it, and that it will be used, Father, for this extension of your kingdom, for your word, for we pray, and we ask it from you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Some of you may have noticed that I was sitting there and the service started, and then, unfortunately, I come up and walk to the back. The reason for that was I wanted to see what was in the prayer book, but there was nothing written there. Just remind you that there is that little book at the back there, that if there are items that you would like us to pray for, do put them in that book, and we can then bring that and lay those things before the Lord as a congregation together here. So that was why I had that little interlude with them, sorry. Now we come to a time of worship, and so let's see.
So these songs tonight are all a little bit about creation and just a reflection.
To God, you have known great things you have done. So love you, that you gave us your Son. What a tremendous gift, Father, that you gave us, Father, to be a ransom, Father, for many, that you shed his blood upon the cross of Calvary. Father, through his blood we have access into your wonderful presence. Father, we do magnify the measure of the love that you have for each and for every one of us. Indeed, that love that Jesus stretched out his arms and they nailed them to the cross. That is a measure of the love of God. The love that you have reached for every one of us. So move in our midst tonight. Help us to return that glory and that praise into your wonderful name. For we ask you, Father, and pray it in Jesus' name.
Thank you for your creation, Lord, and for the Jesus Christ, my King.
wind out of his treasuries. Your name, O Lord, endures forever. Your fame, O Lord, will throughout all generations. Amen.
Thank you. Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Thank you for your warm welcome and the fellowship that we've shared already today. Just a little bit about me. My name is Lee. I've been in pastoral ministry for 20 years. I was a church leader before I took up this role. I'm married to one wife, and I've got three children, one at university, one about to go to university, and one who's just finished GCSEs. We're not sure how they've gone. That's the one his mother's worried about. So yeah, that's our youngest. And it's a pleasure to be with you. My role is speaking at churches on behalf of Open Doors. I look after the north of England, so everywhere from Sheffield up to Scotland, speaking at churches, prayer meetings, things like that, and sharing the work of what God is doing through his persecuted church. I'm going to read from Philippians chapter 1, and that's what I'm basing our thoughts around this evening. I'm going to start at verse 3. Paul writes this: I give thanks to my God for every remembrance of you, always praying with joy for all of you in my every prayer, because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. I'm sure of this, that he who started a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Indeed, it's right for me to think this way about all of you, because I have you in my heart, and you're all partners with me in grace, both in my imprisonment and in the defence and confirmation of the gospel. For God is my witness, how deeply I miss all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus. And I pray this, that your love will keep on growing in the knowledge and every kind of discernment, so that you may approve the things that are superior and may be pure and blameless in the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ, to the glory and praise of God. Now I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that what has happened to me has actually advanced the gospel, so that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to everyone else, that my imprisonment is because I am in Christ. Most of the brothers have gained confidence in the Lord from my imprisonment, and dare even more to speak the word fearlessly. To be sure, some preach Christ out of envy and rivalry, but others out of goodwill. These preach out of love, knowing that I am appointed for the defence of the gospel. The others proclaim Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, thinking that they will cause me trouble in my imprisonment. What does it matter? Only that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is proclaimed, and in this I rejoice. Yes, and I will continue to rejoice, because I know this will lead to my salvation through your prayers and help from the Spirit of Jesus Christ. My eager expectation and hope is that I will not be ashamed about anything, but that now as always, with all courage, Christ will be highly honoured in my body, whether by life or by death, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Just a word about Open Doors. If you don't know our story, this is Brother Andrew, the founder of Open Doors. He died last year. And he founded the ministry as he was a young man in his early 20s. He'd been challenged to go to a conference in Warsaw in Poland. And it was a conference of communist youths from behind the Iron Curtain who were gathering together to celebrate a festival of communism. And Brother Andrew was a Christian, a young evangelist, and he travelled to the conference to witness to Christ. And while he was there, he went to a church, and it was a small gathering in Warsaw, a tiny church. And when he went to the service, they were reading from the scriptures, and the way that they read from the scriptures was there was an old lady who sat in front of the church, and she held up her Bible. And the rest of the church gathered round, and over her shoulder were able to read the words of scripture. And he realised at that moment that there was a church in the communist land that didn't have access to the scriptures, and that were small and were persecuted and felt that they were forgotten. And so he began the ministry of Open Doors, and a ministry which continues to this day of smuggling Bibles. Initially behind the Iron Curtain to the church in communist lands, and then when the Iron Curtain fell, the ministry has spread, and now we're active around the world, wherever Christians are persecuted for their faith. We estimate that 1 in 7 of our Christian family, our brothers and sisters, experience high levels of discrimination or persecution for their faith in Christ. And Open Doors is committed to standing with them, supporting them, encouraging them, and telling their story. This was the verse that God used to challenge Brother Andrew to begin this ministry and gave him a heart for the persecuted church. It's from the book of Revelation. Wake up, strengthen that which remains and is about to die. And this is the life verse of Open Doors, if you like. This is our verse. And encapsulates our ministry. We feel called to stand with and strengthen the persecuted church, our brothers and sisters in Christ, wherever they are, to strengthen them and encourage them that they would not die, but that they would remain where God has set them, and they will testify to his grace and his goodness. There's another element to that verse as well. It begins, wake up. And so we have a ministry to the church in the West, the church in this country, to say we need to wake up to what's happening to our brothers and sisters around the world. We need to wake up to what God is doing. We need to pray for them and pray with them and support them in any way that we can. Themed my talk this morning from this passage in Philippians, and I've got 3 points that I want to share this evening to encourage you. I'm going to speak about gospel partnership, gospel advance, and gospel surrender. First, I want to think about gospel partnership. Paul writes this: I give thanks to my God for every remembrance of you, because of your partnership in the gospel. Paul writes this letter to the church in Philippi from prison. He's under house arrest in Rome. He's chained at the wrist to a Roman soldier, a member of the Imperial Guard. And he's writing to a church that are supporting him, that are visiting him, that are encouraging him. Paul began life as Saul the persecutor. And now he's become Paul the persecuted. He founded the church at Philippi. He was the church planter who brought that fellowship together and shared the gospel with them initially. And now they're sharing with him in his time of need. There's a theme of partnership here. I love the words in this chapter where he speaks of the church. Verse 7, I have you in my heart. When he prays for them, he's not just praying through a list of churches that he has founded, but he's praying for people who he carries in his heart. There's a mutuality here, a partnership, a sharing of ministry together. I want to tell you the story of Daniel. This is Daniel. Daniel's an Iraqi. He grew up in Baghdad in Iraq, and he's a Christian and grew up in a Christian family. Mum and dad, both Christians. When he was 16, his family threw a party for him. And in Iraq, when your eldest son is 16, it's a big deal, and so you gather everybody together and you have a big celebration. Well, his relatives were there, school friends, people from the community gathered together. And there was a knock at the door. He ran excited to the door, going to welcome another guest. And he opened the door, and there was nobody there. And there was a parcel on the doorstep, and so he excitedly opened the parcel, thinking it was a present. And there was a letter in the parcel. And he immediately noticed two things about the letter. The first thing he noticed was that it had been dipped in blood. And the second thing he noticed was that it was wrapped around a bullet. And he read the letter. And the letter said, "We know who you are. We know where you live. You won't see the next bullet." And it was a letter from Al-Qaeda. That evening, his father stopped the party, they got rid of the guests, they packed everything they had, all the belongings they could fit in their car, and they drove north to Erbil. They would never go back and live in Baghdad again, it wasn't safe for them. And they started a new life in Erbil, which is in the north of Iraq, in the Kurdish area, where it's safer for Christians. And Daniel was a really smart boy, he did well at school, and he won a scholarship to study abroad. He was trained to be a doctor. And he was just getting to the end of his studies, coming up for his final exams, when he felt God speak to him, the still small voice of the Spirit. And God said to him, "Daniel, I've called you to be a doctor, but not a doctor of people's bodies, a doctor of people's souls." And he understood that as a call to ministry, a call to church leadership. And so he never completed his medical exams. Instead, he returned to Iraq, he returned to Erbil, and he became a priest in his church. He's a member of what's known as the Ancient Church of the East. It's an Orthodox church, it's the largest church in Iraq. He was ordained, he became a pastor and a priest. And in their tradition, the priest don't marry, so he's single, and he was assigned to a small church on the Nineveh Plain, the desert outside of Erbil. Small church in the middle of nowhere, in the middle of the desert. He ministered there for 2 years. And he told me he was really lonely. He had no wife, he had no family nearby. He was just pastoring a small community, literally in the middle of the desert. And then in June 2014, everything changed. ISIS invaded Iraq from the north, from Syria, and they invaded Mosul in a day, and immediately the Christians had to flee. And they fled east from Mosul across the north of Iraq to Erbil to escape ISIS and to seek safety with the Kurds. Dan and Tommy remember standing outside his church doors and looking west towards Mosul and seeing what looked like a great sandstorm. And it wasn't a sandstorm, but it was the dust from the cars and the buses of the Christians who were fleeing towards and escaping Mosul. In one day, 1,300 Christians, families, turned up at his church. A building not much bigger than this, set in a compound, a small congregation. For 2 weeks, they stayed with him. The children slept in the church building, the men slept out under the stars on the bare ground. And he had to find water, and he had to find food, and he had to find supplies, and he had to find blankets, and he had to try and look after this 1,000 people. One night, as he looked out over the children sleeping in his church, he heard again that still small voice of God saying, "This is why I called you into the ministry. For this moment is why I called you." Open Doors was able to come alongside Daniel and support him. were able to help him buy food and water and blankets. And then as people were resettled and found homes and places to live, we were able to provide advice and pastoral care and trauma workshops to help women and children process what they had experienced. And that partnership with the church in Iraq continues to this day. Daniel is now a bishop in his church, a leader in his church. And he said this to me. He said, "My people will forget Al-Qaeda. My people will forget ISIS. But we will never forget our brothers and sisters who stood with us in our time of need." Open Doors was able to partner with Brother Andrew and his church because of your partnership with us. Because you and churches like yours were able to support us financially and in prayer that we can support Brother Andrew and his ministry, Bishop Daniel and his ministry, in prayer and in practical ways. Partnership in the gospel. Second thing I want to speak about is gospel advance. Paul writes this: "What has happened to me has actually advanced the gospel. It's taken the gospel forward. It's taken the gospel to a new place, a place where it wasn't known before." When Paul writes his letter to Timothy, his apprentice, his trainee pastor, he says, "I am in chains, but God's word is not chained." And the testimony of the persecuted church again and again is that persecution is a means that God uses to further the gospel. To take the gospel to places where it's never been before. In prisons. In dark places. In hidden places. Every year at Open Doors we produce this book. Called the World Watch List. It's a guide to the 50 countries where persecution is most fierce around the world. And number one on this list, the place where we believe it's hardest, most dangerous to be a Christian, is North Korea. Every year, Christians in North Korea are persecuted for their faith. If you're discovered to be a Christian or to own a Bible, you'll be sent to a labor camp and often worked until death. Every year, Christians and non-Christians seek to escape from North Korea and they travel across the border into China. And there they live as illegal refugees. And if they're caught by the Chinese police, they'll be sent back to North Korea. Sometimes they'll be executed, other times they'll be sent to their camp. Open Doors has a ministry amongst these refugees in China, encouraging those who are Christians, sharing the gospel with those who are not Christians. I'm going to share a film now of one of our, what we call, undercover field workers. A lady who works with women who've escaped from North Korea and who now live illegally in China. Some of whom are Christians, others who are not Christians.
This short film is a reenactment of true events following an undercover field ministering to trafficked North Korean women.
The spy is the one I miss the most. She acted suspiciously when she first arrived. My guess is she was sent to monitor our secret Bible studies and report us to the authorities. Other field workers like me have been caught and imprisoned. But it's a risk I'm willing to take in order to share the gospel. And the women I'm going to see take far worse risks in coming to hear it. The women I travel to see escaped North Korea and are now illegal refugees. Most of them are victims of human traffickers, sold to local men as wives, or as prostitutes into brothels. If caught, the refugees are taken from their families, sent back to North Korea, and serve long sentences in labor camps, or they are executed. It's a long trip to a remote area to meet them. I have to avoid the police, avoid surveillance, any place with identification. I travel alone using illegal drivers. The way must be new every time. Never the same driver, never the same path. But I am not alone. God goes with me. He prepares a way for me. These women lead harsh lives, often mistreated and abused. They are not always ready to hear the truth. They don't understand. Who could love them like this Jesus can? At our meetings, we worship together. And over time, they go from laughing at the gospel to being transformed by it. But sometimes, I worry that I'm too late. That the women were found out. Perhaps by a spy. And have been sent back to North Korea to face horrors beyond our imagining. They risk their lives to hear the gospel. Prayer is essential to what we do. Support from the body of Christ all over the world keeps us doing this work. God's love compels our love, our call to serve each other, despite the danger. And being with them is my greatest joy. Everyone is precious, a child of God. And I would make the journey every time, even for one. Even for the spy. I often dream about the spy. Why didn't she turn us in? Was she really a spy? Did she hear God with us? At times, she wept with us and worshipped with us. Other times, she did not. I wonder how she encounters God these days.
Praise God for the faithfulness of these undercover field workers despite the risks they face. Please pray for God's special protection on them and their families. Pray for the North Korean trafficked women who attend the Bible study meetings. Pray that they will be strengthened as disciples of Christ each time they meet together. Please remember the many secret Christians inside North Korea who face imprisonment and even death if their faith is discovered. Pray that God will give them strength and peace.
Gospel partnership, gospel advance, just want to close our time by thinking about gospel surrender. My eager hope is that I will not be ashamed about anything, but that now as always, Christ will be highly honoured in my body, whether by life or death. Paul goes on to write, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." The Lord Jesus said that if anyone would come after him, they must deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow him. And of course, the cross is a symbol of surrender. It's a symbol of self-denial. The Lord Jesus himself, on the night he was betrayed, prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, knowing the cross was before him. "Lord, not my will, but your will be done." And so the call for a Christian, anyone who follows Jesus, is to deny oneself and to put him first and to live with him as our Lord and our Saviour, our captain. To put his will before our will, to live lives of surrender to him. And sometimes that is a great joy, and sometimes there is freedom in that, and sometimes that is a great hardship, and there is challenge in that. And one of the provocations for me as a Christian has been getting to know leaders and members of the persecuted church. and to see how they live out this life of surrender and this life of discipleship and this life of walking the way of the cross. One of the statistics that I learned when I joined Open Doors, which shocked me and still shocks me, is that around the world every day, we estimate that on average 15 Christians lose their lives for following the Lord Jesus Christ. They walk the way of the cross. And even more shocking is that out of those 15 who lose their lives, 14 are Nigerians. There are more Christians killed in Nigeria each year than the rest of the world put together. Last year in Nigeria, over 5,000 Christians lost their lives because of their testimony of following the Lord Jesus. You know anything about North Africa, North Nigeria? There are many Christian villages in the north, but there's a jihadist insurgency going on across the north of the country. A group known as Boko Haram, a terrorist group, are very active there, and they're seeking to drive Christians out of their lands, burning down villages, attacking pastors, kidnapping Christian children. You're familiar with the story of the Chibok schoolgirls, burning down and destroying churches. I'm going to show you now another film that shows the story of what this looks like through the eyes of one young man, a man called Ayuba.
At night, we heard the first gunshot. My father said we should all run. My siblings and I began to run for our lives. The next day, we went back home. Everywhere was silent. When we approached our house, I could see three boys on the ground.
Moved at the end when I see that film and you see the picture of the real Ayuba, reminds us that we're talking about real people, not just facts and figures and numbers. At the end of our service today, I'll be at the back over there. There's a little table, I've got some resources with me. If you'd like to pray with and for the people I've talked about and others like them. We've got prayer resources, I've got some here, you can sign up for these, have them sent to you so that you can stand with our persecuted family and pray for them and pray God's grace and protection and favour upon them. So if you'd like to know any more about that, you can see at the end of the service. Also, if you'd like to know more about Open Doors, this book, God's Smuggler, is the autobiography of Brother Andrew, our founder. It tells the story of his life and how the ministry started. This and all of our resources are free, so again, if you'd like one of these, just come and see me at the end of our service. I wonder if we could close this part of our service with a time of prayer. So, can I invite you to stand? Lovely to hear the prayers there, there's different people around the church led us in prayer. I wonder if one or two, three or four would lead us in prayer. Pray for the church in the Middle East and leaders like Bishop Daniel. Pray for Rebecca and other workers like her ministering to refugees in China. And pray for Ayuba and others across Africa who are suffering for their faith in Christ. Let's pray. take a seat. I'm going to turn now to the time of communion. And when we have communion, I'm always reminded of something somebody once said to me. I had a significant birthday a few years ago, and my family paid for me to go and learn how to bake bread. A few years ago, I got into baking. I started baking bread, and my wife, I think, decided, well, if you're going to do this, you better learn how to do it properly. And so she sent me off on a course at a bakery with a French baker who's an expert in breaking bread. And we had a day together learning how to make all these wonderful different types of bread. And it began early in the morning. So it began about 7 o'clock, and we got to the bakery to brew first, and we had to get all the things out and started to prepare stuff. And we began by making croissants. And we made these wonderful croissants and then cooked them in the ovens. The smell was fantastic. And then we brought the croissants out and the fancy breads, and we had breakfast together. And when we'd finished the breakfast, this French baker said to us, "And now we are companions. And now we are companions." And he explained that in French, the word companion comes from the word pan, which means bread. And the root of the word companion is those who break bread together. And he wasn't a Christian, but I thought that's a wonderful explanation about what communion's all about. It's a reminder that we are the body of Christ, that we are companions, that we share in the fellowship one with another, and the fellowship of Christ and his sufferings and his glorification. And we are companions, we are brothers and sisters with the persecuted church around the world. So I'm going to read from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, where Paul writes to the church about communion. "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread. And when he'd given thanks, broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he also took the cup. And after supper, he said, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Let's just have a moment of quiet. And Father, we confess before you and your Son and the Spirit that we are not worthy to receive these gifts. We are not worthy of the Lord Jesus Christ. But seeing your nature, always have mercy and to extend the hand of grace towards us. And so we come, not because we must, but because we may. And we come not presuming upon our own righteousness, but upon your grace and your mercy. Lord, we seek your forgiveness for the things we know we've done and you know we've done this last week. And we seek your forgiveness for the things that we know we should have done but haven't. Lord, forgive us, we pray. Amen.
Stewards would like to distribute the gifts, and then our leaders in prayer for the bread and then the wine.
So Heavenly Father, we thank you for this gift of bread, reminder to us that Jesus is the bread of life and there's salvation in no other name under heaven. May it be to us the body of Christ. Amen. So, Father, we thank you for this gift of wine, the fruit of the vine. Reminder to us that Jesus' blood was shed for us and for the sins of the world. And that in him there is forgiveness and grace and new life. May it be to us the blood of Christ. Crucified, dead and buried, risen and ascended and reigning with you. We offer you afresh our souls and our bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. In the name of Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Lee, for bringing God's word to us this evening. Thank you, too, for bringing us a very small picture of Christians in other areas of the world. I wonder, have you been challenged? I've been challenged once again. Let's keep that challenge in our hearts as we go into this week, as we go into this month, as we go into this year, and for the rest of our lives. Please do spend time to take the literature that is there. It will reinforce that challenge that you have had already. And so,
So we're thankful that we've got the opportunity to live in freedom like this, and so many of our brothers and sisters around the world have to live in secret and persecuted and martyred for their faith. So just thank you, Lord, for the work of opening doors, and just pray, Lord, for the life and have something to think about tonight. Pray as we go our separate ways, Lord, we'll be with us and just keep us safe. This could be a system.
Thank you.